Good morning. I'm so glad all of you are here. Praise God. You know what? Where two or more are gathered. Amen. God is with us. We're going to praise Him this morning. And I know there are others coming. There are others waking. Therefore, God exalted Him to the highest place and gave Him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow. Father God, we thank You for this morning. All this praise is for You who alone are worthy. Amen.
Did you feel the mountains tremble? Did you hear the oceans roar? When the people rose to sing of Jesus Christ, the risen one. Did you feel the people tremble? Did you hear the singers roar? Yeah. When the chorus began to sing of Jesus Christ, the Savior.
Wonderful and beautiful day. So glad that you're here. Holy Spirit, Father God, we just pray right now that You would just fall afresh on us. Let us just feel Your presence stirring within us, Lord Father God. And the rest that we need, Lord Father God, just let it overwhelm us. In Your name, in the name that is above all names, in the name of Jesus.
Spirit was moving over the water. Spirit, come move over us. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. As the Spirit was moving over the water. Spirit, come move over us. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. Come down, Spirit, when you move, you make my heart pound. When you feel the room, you're here and I know you are moving. I'm here and I know you can feel me. Come down, Spirit, when you move, you make my heart pound. When you feel the room, you're here and I know you are moving. I'm here and I know you can feel me. With me.
As the Spirit was moving over the water, Spirit, come rest over us.
Yeah.
Come rest on us. Come rest on us. As the Spirit was moving over the water, Spirit, come move over us. Come rest on us.
Feel the room.
Yeah. You're here and I know
you're moving.
I know you're moving.
You know, I like to pray that whatever it is that I'm doing, if whatever it is that I'm a part of or whatever it is that I'm building, that it would be through the Holy Spirit, because I know that if it's of me, I know it will just burn and fade away. But if it's of the Holy Spirit, it's everlasting. It's everlasting and it's good.
Here is where I lay it down, every burden, every crown. This is my surrender. This is my surrender. Here is where I lay it down, every lie and every doubt. This is my surrender. Do whatever you want to do whatever you want to. And I will make room for you to do whatever you want to do whatever you want to. Jesus.
Out with me.
Here is where I lay it down, every burden, every crown. This is my surrender. This is my surrender. Here is where I lay it down, every lie and every doubt. This is my surrender. Yeah.
Amen. Father God, we thank you so much for this glorious day. You are worthy of everything that we have, Lord. We bless you this morning, Lord God. In the name of Jesus and all his church said, amen. Please welcome Miss Natalie. You may be seated.
Good morning. I want to invite all the kiddos to come up front so you can see and hear what we're learning this morning. Good morning. I know that Pastor Michael will say this in just a bit, but just as a reminder, next Sunday we'll be having one joint service at 11 o'clock to celebrate our 70th year here at St. Andrew's. And so it's a look back, but mostly a look ahead at the next 70 years. That's a long time, isn't it? It's pretty amazing for sure. So I have some big pictures here, and I'm going to need your help talking about them today. You think y'all are up for the challenge? Okay, so there's lots of things that capture our attention, right? Lots and lots of things, and lots of things that take up a lot of time in our lives, right? So I have some pictures here. Let's see if you guys can shout out so the people in the back can hear. What do you think that is?
School.
Do we spend a lot of time at our school?
Yeah.
Yeah, we do, right? A lot of time at school. What about TV? Does TV sometimes take up a lot of our time? Watching movies and shows and who knows what else. And what about, oh, don't fall on me here. Let's see if I can balance this out a little bit better here. All right, JW's here. Okay, what about all this stuff? What do we have here? I've got a computer and a tablet and a phone, which hopefully not. But electronics, right? That can take up a lot of our time and a lot of our attention. What is that? Video games. A controller, yes. What about this? Just people, right? Being around people. Yeah, and they look like they're having a lot of fun. So we spend a lot of time either at certain places, school where we're taught things, right? We have teachers that teach us things. School, and maybe we watch TV and see movies and commercials and things that capture our attention, and TV tries to tell us different things too. We can learn from there too, right? And then maybe you have a tablet or you're peeking at a phone at different things here. Takes up time, has our attention, and it's trying to teach us different things too. So today what we're talking about in our lesson is, where do you think we should be learning the most from? What do you think? Do y'all have a good idea? What do you think? You think school? Anybody else? Kenneth? School? What else? School? Yeah? School? I love this. Your teachers would really love this. School? Okay, awesome. Well, what if I held this up and showed you this picture?
The Bible.
Yeah. So the Bible. Sometimes maybe this is not where we're spending the most of our time, but do you think this is where we should do the most of our learning out of the Bible? Yes, we really should. And is there a place that we go that helps us to do that?
Church!
Church! I know, I tried to find a St. Andrew's picture, but this is going to have to do for today. But church, right? Because we trust that the church is teaching us the good things that come in this special book that we call the Bible, right? And if you guys remember, last week we got to celebrate our wonderful third graders getting to receive their special Bible. But what we always say is that in this book, and those of you that do chapel with me at school will know this, we know that inside of this, it is absolutely true, that everything the Bible says is absolutely true. So the reason I'm showing you these pictures is that you bet your teachers are probably teaching you wonderful things at school. But there's going to be kids on the playground and different things that try to tell us things that maybe aren't so true from the Bible. And we have to know, we have to be wise to know that sometimes we see things, whoops, on TV. Thank you. I have all the helpers up here. Sometimes we hear things at school. Sometimes we hear things on the TV. Sometimes we hear things from friends and people around us, but we need to know
the Bible
so that we can be wise. Can you say, be wise?
Be wise.
Be wise and know what God has to say about that. Because guess what? Who is the boss of all things? God. So one of my favorite Bible verses, and I wrote it down this way because this is the way your Bible says it. And I like the way it says it. It says, don't copy the things that the world is doing and the things that the world wants you to think, but transform your mind. So I can do that by spending time reading my Bible, right? So that I can see what God really wants for me. Not by watching TV. Not even by all the amazing things that you will learn and see at school. But that the Bible should be the book that I always go to. And hopefully, when I come to church, the lessons that we learn at church, I can walk out the door and be really wise in making choices that make God's heart happy. Don't you think that's a great idea?
Yeah.
All right, will you pray with me? You know what? Actually, before we pray, I'm wearing something different today. I've got my St. Andrew's t-shirt on that all the people that work with the young kids wear. Do you want to know why? On the back is a verse from the Bible, and it says this, I have no greater joy than to know that my children are walking in the truth. Do you know that every parent sitting out here, any grown-up in here that's looking down at you kids, has so much joy if they think and know that you are walking in the truth? And which of these was the truth? The Bible. I have no greater joy than to know that my kids know the truth. And the truth is the Bible. Will you pray with me now? Let's pray together. God, we thank you so much. We thank you for the children of this church, Lord. And we thank you, Lord, for your word that is true, God. I pray that every single child that sets foot here would hear the truth, Lord, and walk in that truth all the days of their life. We thank you, God, for all of the many blessings, and especially for your son, Jesus. It's in his name that we pray. Amen. So kiddos, I'm going to meet you back there. Everybody else, we're so glad that you're here this morning and invite you to pass the peace and tell each other good morning and hello.
Amen. We're going to sing a song called You Know My Name, and I just think about God and how he sent his only son here, and how knowing his name and speaking his name is power in and of itself. Brings healing, brings salvation, reconciliation. The things that we need as we travail here. So sing this with me. Yeah.
2 hours this morning. Give somebody a fist bump and sit down. Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Man, I am in deep allergy voice this morning. Oh yeah. I got my little Barry White thing going on. Like, you hold my hand. Yeah, it takes a different. Jenna holds my hand. So I have in my hands lucky opportunity. I'm so glad you came today. So glad. I'm sorry, I am bereft in my duties. Good morning, everybody. I want to take a moment to say good morning to all of you watching online, wherever you're watching from. We're so happy you dialed in with us this morning. Thanks for being a part of our community. We love you, and we'd love for you to be here if you're able. If not, we like that you're joining us wherever you're watching us from. I hope that you're using the filter that makes me look skinnier this morning. And those of you here in-house, we're so excited to have you with us. Can I say good morning to my balcony people? Bringing it up there this morning. How about the Nave? Good morning, Nave. Y'all should be embarrassed, really. I mean, look how many of you there are. And look, turn around. There's like four people up there, and they just blasted you. Yeah, look, they're doing the wave up there now. That is, they used to do one of those things. That is greatness. And good morning, Transept. Other side. As always, next level. I'm so happy you're here, and I know what you're going. What are these things he's holding in his hands? I'm so glad you asked that question. So there are people that sit up there, and I can't tell who's up there this morning, that run our, is that Dave? Yeah. Yes, all right, I saw some shininess up top, so I was like, that's got to be Dave. He got no hair. Dave's up there running the lyrics for us, and I didn't give him an image for today, so it's just going to say Michael Crocker the entire time. It's going to be really awkward. He runs our lyrics, and he's kind of the chief guy that's been running our lyrics for a while. But Dave likes to worship with his wife every now and then. And sometimes Dave leaves town, and he goes and does things that Dave, I don't know what Dave does, but Dave does things, I'm sure. So we would like for your help in this regard. We would love for you to help us on this lyrics team. Now, as I've said before when I've mentioned this, I don't want to minimize what Dave does, because Dave is amazing, as are the two high school helpers that help us. But these are your qualifications that you need to have. Everybody hold up your right hand, or if you're left-handed, hold up your left hand, and then stick out just your pointer finger, and then do this. You have the ability. Mitchell, play along. I see that you're not doing this. So you have the ability. That's what you got to do. Right? Now there's a little more to it. If things go awry, you have to move a mouse, and everybody can move a mouse around. It's okay. You have the ability to do it. We would love for you to, look, we don't need you to be up there every week, because Dave actually loves to do it. He loves to be up there and to participate in this way, but we want to give you an opportunity to help. Maybe once every other month, you go up there and you do this service where you are. So here's what's going to happen is you all know that I'm a distractible person, right? I see squirrels where there are no squirrels all the time. And so I'm going to ask you to pass these around during my sermon. How distracting is that? Because it's going to get to Mitchell over there, and he's just going to sit on it. He's just like, I'm not going to pass it around anymore. That's right. See, you don't play along with the games, and I point you out there, Mr. Mitchell. But if you would, just pass these around. And if you feel, if God, this isn't guilt, this is an opportunity. This is God saying, now's your moment, step in. To really use the gifts of a pointer finger. That God, not everybody has a pointer finger. And you do. And you can use that, a gift. So if you feel so inclined, don't feel like you have to sign your name out. And I'm not watching to see who's doing it, but Jesus is. And so if you have that ability, and we would love for your help, and really it's not for everybody. Some people would sweat uncontrollably of the pressure of running the lyrics up there. So I don't want you to think that, you know, you have, if no one signs it today, that's okay. God will provide. But I have a feeling there's some of you out there, some of you in this room, even in the balcony, who can just move over a few rows and run the lyrics for us. There you go. Okay, so was that good, Dave? Sweet. Yesterday we had a wonderful event here, and with the Holy Smokers put on a brisket cooking competition. I got to be one of the judges, so I tried all 9 briskets, and there were some really, really, really good ones, and there was one that was not good at all. It was not good, and I'm not going to say who it was, because I actually don't know who it was, but you should be ashamed of yourself for turning something like that in. It wasn't that bad, actually. I just wanted to make it sound like it was worse than it was. They were all actually really good. But it was such a fun night, and we had Luke Olson playing music here, and we raised thousands of dollars. I don't know the final number, but it's thousands of dollars to send a convoy of hope for Hurricane Ian relief. And that is just amazing that those guys, the Holy Smokers. So if you were here last night, thanks for being here. It was a lot of fun throwing cornhole. We had football games going on everywhere. Some people were more happy about that than others. And it was just a great, wonderful evening. So thanks to Joey, who really kind of arranged that, and everybody who contributed and did a part of it. Next week, we have one service. It's our birthday. Hey, St. Andrews, it's our birthday. Come on, that joke's not going to get old for me until y'all start playing along and doing this, and then I'll stop it. We are turning 70 years old this year, and our first service was actually in July, but we didn't want to do it in July because it's hot, y'all, in July, and none of y'all are here anyway. So we chose football and hunting season, which also a lot of people disappear for. But we're going to do it next Sunday, October 30th, one service here. We'll celebrate together. All three worshiping bodies will come together at the 11 o'clock service. And then right after the service, Susan Mace, one of our volunteers, she sings in the choir at the 9:15, she's a professional photographer. She's going to stand in the balcony. We're all going to gather together like we do for VBS pictures, those of you who've been here for it. We're going to turn and look at the balcony and take a group photo together, which will be really cool. Because if you've ever been in the church offices, the hallway that leads to mine, there's our very first congregational photo, which was taken in 1952 outside in front of the Woodman the World building. And it's just awesome. I look at that photo almost every day when I pass by it. I just stop for a second and look, and I'm like, because of them, I'm here. It's a totally cool thing. And so we're going to take that picture, and we're going to hang it right next to those old people and look at it. And I'll get to say, and I'll go, hey, because of them, I'm here. And hopefully in another 70 years, some pastor, because it won't be me, will be walking by and go, hey, because of that knucklehead right there in the center, I'm here. How cool is that? So we'd love for you to be here, and it is confirmed. It's been ordered. She's baking it. Kathy Young cake, everybody. Come on. Woo! Yes. It's not a three-tiered monster, okay? It's a sheet cake. Everybody settle down, but still, you know, it's a Kathy Young sheet cake, and it's going to be amazing. So thanks, Melissa, who ordered it for us. I'm excited about next week. I'm going to show a little video about our history, and we're going to talk a little bit about our future, our past 70, and what our next 70 can look like. So I'm excited about it. So please come next Sunday. But today, I had a three-part sermon series planned for last week, this week, and next. And it was called The Simple Life. And it was about bringing simplicity to your life, right? Because I feel like I need that in my life. But I'm not going to give any of that information to you. So I hope you're all comfortable in the complexities of your life, because that's what it is now. But Pastor Cape came, he called and said, hey, can I come? And I was like, that's amazing. He's like, oh, you know what? We should do a birthday party to celebrate. So that threw it off. And so I was like, okay, so what am I going to do on this little lone Sunday? Because I'm not a standalone preacher. I like sermon series, right? I like to tie things together. And because I have a lot that goes on up here, and it can't all fit out in 23 minutes. So what are we going to do? So I was sitting over there, where Jordan's sitting, last week during the 9:30. When Pastor Cape was up here, and he made you all get up, those of you who are here, and scoot forward. And so they moved over there, and then they were getting all snooty with me because I didn't sit over there. Like, these two right there are like, why don't you come over here? And I'm like, no, I never get to sit and listen to a sermon, so I'm going to sit by myself and listen. And he said to grab the Bible. I don't know if you remember this. And so I grabbed a pew Bible that was sitting right there, and I grabbed it. And I went to Luke, where the prodigal son story is, Luke 15. And I think that, and then I just started flipping around, and I was listening to him, as y'all listen to me too, right? And I was like, God, what do you want me to do next week? And I was just flipping around. I was looking at, you want to go to Ecclesiastes? Oh, that'd be good. No, not Ecclesiastes. How about the Chronicles? Ooh, let's read through the Chronicles. That's a riveting story right there. Let's just go through the begat section of stuff. And I was flipping through, and I was like, I landed on 2 John. And I was like, I'm going to read this, because look, if someone ever challenges you, I need you to read a book of the Bible today, choose 2 John. It's 13 verses, right? And if you want to brag about it, yep, you spent some time in Scripture, read a whole book of the Bible today. Well, what'd you read? Psalm 119? That's like 172 verses. No, 2 John 13, right? Just boom, just get it in there. So I sat down and I started reading it, and while Pastor Cape was talking, if you're watching this, Cape, I was totally listening, great sermon. I did listen, and we talked about his sermon between services. So I sat down, I read it, and I'm like, ooh, this is good. Because I haven't, like, I don't go to the letters of, like, the little letters very often. Like, if I'm going to read stuff, unless it's in my year-long reading plan, which right now I've switched plans and I'm doing just Old Testament Psalms. I'm in Joshua and in Psalms right now. And I'll eventually get to 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John, Jude, hey, Jude, right? And I'm going to read that one. And I'll get to those. But I don't often, when I'm going to Scripture, go, I want to read one of the smaller letters of the Bible. I'll go to Paul all day long because I love Paul. And I'm going to go to the Gospels first, right? If I'm just going to dig into something, I'm going to go to the story of Jesus. Like, how many of you, like, have read 2 John recently, other than right now as you're sitting there and you did it? Yeah, like you. How many of you have, like, oh, yeah, 2 John? Totally, that was last week. Yeah, right, because how many of you knew that there was a 2 John? Right? Yeah, so there's 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John. And I was reading, I was like, that's good stuff. Like, this should be somewhere. Oh, wait, it is. It's in Scripture, right? It's in the Bible. It made the canon. And then I went and I read 3 John, which is a little longer. It's 15 verses, but I got through it. And I was like, ooh, that's good stuff too. And then so I went back, and this wasn't during the sermon, this was later. I went back and I read 1 John, which he was a little lengthy. It was 5 chapters. He had a lot more to say there. And they all tie together, and I was like, oh, this is great. I was like, yeah, I'm going to do 2 John. And then I started doing my study on 2 John because I hadn't spent a lot of time there. And so it begins this way. This letter is from John the Elder. Okay, well, who's that? Right, because I've always thought that these were from the Apostle John, right? The book of John, 1st, 2nd, 3rd John, Revelation. That's my boy John. He wrote all those. But why is he calling himself the Elder? And so when I started looking in this, there's two thoughts about this. Is one, that it is the Apostle John, and he's just older. He's like, I'm John. Remember me? Because when I started following Jesus, I was like 9 or 10 years old. That's how old John was when he started following Jesus. He's the only disciple to live out his age and die of natural causes. Everybody else was executed. John lived a whole lot longer. Subsequently, we get these letters that are deeper into history than anyone else had something written. And he has this whole revelation thing that God delivers to him that's just crazy and amazing and beautiful and scary at the same time. So, yeah, you can go, yeah, I'm John the Elder. Like, I'm John the man. Like, y'all know who I'm talking about? Like, I'm John. He had to say deep, I'm John. Like that. But there's other people who say that this is a guy who lived in Ephesus. And he was a guy and he was an elder. An elder is a title that is put upon you. And it's something like when Paul would go in to set up churches, he would anoint elders. And these elders would have the spiritual authority over this local church. But clearly in this letter, this guy has authority over much bigger area. Like he's writing to a specific congregation. We'll get into that in a second. But he clearly has authority over them. My belief is that this is the Apostle John. And he's writing from Ephesus to a church that he had been to. But he has this spiritual authority over them because he's John. He walked with Jesus. He was the dude when Jesus is on the cross and he looks at his mom and he goes, Mother, this is your son. Son, this is your mother. Right? That's kind of a big deal. John's a big deal. And he writes this letter. He goes, hey, I am writing this letter. This letter is from John the Elder. I am writing to the chosen lady and to her children whom I love in the truth. Wait, what? I'm writing to the chosen lady and her children. That sounds weird, doesn't it? And again, there's like, okay, well, who's he talking about? And some people say he's talking about Mary. He's the chosen lady, right? Because Jesus, like, he put them together, and he's like, hey, this is good. Mom, you need to look after him as if he was me. John, you need to look after her as if you were me. that's a lot of weight right there. But so some people say that he's writing to her. Others say that he's writing to Mary Magdalene. That's just stupid. There's no justification for that. What really is going on here, and what's most likely going on here, what I believe is going on, is he's writing to a church. But why does he call it the chosen lady and to her children? Well, we have to step back a little bit and put ourselves in the time and place in which he's writing, because it addresses everything that 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John are all about. He's writing to a church, a congregation, at the birth of the church, right? So the church is just starting to get its ground and its wheels going. In the early days of the church, right, in Acts, right? So we go back into the book of Acts. Jesus has come, he's died, he's conquered death. He comes back to the disciples and he goes, here's your job. Go into the world and tell people about me. Create the church. And so Peter is up there. The Holy Spirit descends upon them in that room, if you remember. Then he preaches the best sermon ever. 3,000 people come in to know Jesus that day. The church grows. And then it goes on and it says, and then thousands more. Like the church is just exploding onto the scene as people are talking about Jesus and hearing about Jesus for the first time. All of these people, the disciples, are spreading out now across the country and telling people about Jesus. They're doing what Jesus told them to do. And people are coming into the knowledge of who Jesus is. But they had to do it undercover because it was illegal. Like the church was so persecuted. It was because they're going into a world, and Jesus knows this. He's like, I'm sending you into this world that worships a plethora of gods. Like there's a God for everything. And you're going into this Greek and Roman system that has a God for every day, every season, everything. Every village has their own God. And very shortly, emperor is going to declare himself God. I am the one true God. And then his son is going to say, well, then I'm the son of God. And he comes onto the scene. If you don't bow down and worship me, we have a cross ready for you. And so there's this horrible movement of violence to try to get rid of the church. And so these groups of people who were meeting, these churches were meeting in homes. They were meeting in shops. They were meeting in secret places to tell about Jesus. They were loving one another and caring for one another because it was a life and death circumstance. And they go in. So Debbie and I were in Israel. We're in Turkey together. And there's this place in Turkey called Sardis. It's one of the seven churches mentioned in the book of Revelation. But the Roman road goes through there. And you can walk. It's amazing. You can like walk where Paul walked. It's just like because they've uncovered these stones. And like he walked here. That's just super cool. And so you walk. And I remember this one street that we're walking down. And they've uncovered these stores. Like it would have been like a strip mall, essentially. And there's one store, and I don't know if you remember this, that carved into you walk in the store and carved into the side of the wall, the stone wall, is an ichthus. You all know what an ichthus is, right? It's the little Christian fish. And it's carved in right there. That was such a courageous move for that shopkeeper. Because what it told everyone who knew what that symbol meant is, I believe in Jesus. I am living my life and I'm doing everything for Jesus. If you didn't know what it meant, it didn't mean anything to you. But if you walked in there, you go, oh, this person's a Jesus person. I mean, we put ichthus on the back of our car, right? You ever seen somebody with an ichthus in the back of their car and they're flipping you off and honking at you as they drive by? Like, oh, Jesus be with you too, my sister. Thanks, ma'am, right? You know, it's just like, we have no fear of wearing our faith out there, of putting it on display, and we don't seem to follow it when we do. This is a big deal for them. It was a time of utter persecution, and so what John is doing is he's writing in a time where he's like, hey, I don't want this letter to fall into the wrong hands, and so I'm not going to dime out who the leaders are here. Hey, to the chosen lady, to my church, and to her children, the people in it. Right, so he's writing in this unbelievably persecuting time for the church, and he's trying to address something that's tearing the church apart. And so he goes in, he says, to lady and her children, whom I love in the truth, as of everyone else who knows the truth, because the truth lives in us and will be forever with us. You think truth's important to John? I mean, he drops it 3 times right here in the first verse. I'm writing to you in truth, as does everyone else who knows the truth, because the truth lives in us and will be with us forever. Grace, mercy, and peace, which comes from God the Father and from Jesus Christ, the Son of the Father, will continue to be with us who live and wait for it, truth and love. So what's going on here is there's been this spreading of falseness in the church community, in the Christian community. There's been spreading of things that feel right, but they aren't right. And John's writing to this church, and he's going to write again to them in 3 John and really drop some names. Here he doesn't. Here he's just kind of, it's his first shot to them. He says, I'm writing to you in truth for those who know the truth, and because the truth's always going to be with us who live in truth and love. He says, how happy I was to meet some of your children and find them living according to the truth, just as the Father commanded. He says, I'm writing to remind you, dear friends, that we should love one another. This is not a new commandment, but one we have had from the beginning. Love means doing what God has commanded us. And he has commanded us to love one another, just as you've heard from the beginning. I say this because many deceivers have gone too far. They deny that Jesus Christ came in a real body. Such a person is a deceiver and an antichrist. Watch out that you do not lose what we have worked so hard to achieve. Be diligent so that you receive your full reward. Anyone who wanders away from this teaching has no relationship with God. But anyone who remains in the teaching of Christ has a relationship with both the Father and the Son. If anyone comes to your meeting and does not teach the truth about Christ, don't invite that person into your home or give any kind of encouragement. Anyone who encourages such people becomes a partner in their evil work. I have much more to say to you, but I don't want to waste it on pen and paper, for I hope to come visit you and talk face to face. Then our joy will be complete. Greetings from the children of your sister, chosen by God. This letter, he's laying out, and he's going to go deeper into it in 3 John, and he's really pulling from what he did in his first letter. But he's setting out the situation at hand. He's like, and he begins by saying, remember the truth, remember the truth, remember the truth. We are people of the truth. What's the truth? Jesus Christ is the truth, the Son of God. He says it in 1 John in chapter 4. He's like, hey, Jesus came and he suffered and he sacrificed and he gave his life so that we might have ours. That is love. Because he loved us, go and love one another. See, John's setting this whole way of life out apart from the rest of the world. But what's happening is there's people who are coming and who are teaching a new truth. And they're like, well, yes, but that's not the real truth now. See, the Greek word, when I said, I say this because many deceivers have gone too far. The Greek there is talking about a mind state. That these people have gone too far in their thinking. It's progressive thinking. It's this progressive deconstructing of the faith. And what people are doing is they're coming in and they're saying, these teachers were traveling around and they're delivering a new message, one that feels right, but it's off just a little. There was a book, an early Christian book, and it's the rules of governance for the church. It's called the Didache. And the Didache was written by the church leaders to kind of rein some stuff in, because, I mean, when they're building the church, they're like just creating, and there was no systems and no structure. And I'm not a systems or structure kind of person, which is why we hired an executive pastor, because you need systems and structure and organization to get all the squirrels in line and go in the right direction. And so the church was with all these different places where Paul was going to set up these churches and John was setting up these churches, and they're anointing these leaders, and these leaders are going, okay, well, what do we do in this case? What do we do in this situation? All right, let's create a little governance here. And so they create this book, and it was called the Didache. And it was the very first book of kind of Christian organization. And one of the things it addressed was it addressed the three different types of leaders. It addressed kind of the apostles, and they were the guys who walked with Jesus. They're the ones who he talked with, who he spoke to, who they had some encounter with. Their authority was everywhere, and it was not questioned because they walked with the man, right? Then there's these elders, and these elders were anointed by the apostles or by the people who were planting the churches, and they had kind of a local authority. They were in charge of their local congregation. But then there was also these prophets, and the prophets were kind of, we call them itinerant preachers in the Methodist history. They were people who went around from church to church, and they would bring the news of God with them, and they would teach about Jesus, and they would help. You know, it's like Pastor Cape was a prophet for us. He comes in, he delivers a message, he gives me a break, and the sheep grow because of the feeding from a flock, right? And so you have these people who would go around. But see, the problem was that people were, as people do, taking advantage of this. And so prophets would come into town, and they would say, they would come in, and like the Didache says, if a prophet stays more than 2 days, kick him out because he's not a real prophet. unless there's some extenuating circumstances where he must stay for a third. But after three, get rid of him. If a prophet comes in and during his time, because sometimes prophets would come in and they would get into like a trance and they would start speaking this holy language and deliver the words from, like, I'm, you know, it's like, oh, you should reward Michael with a large steak and a nice bottle of wine. Amen. So what did I say in my trance? Oh, a steak and a bottle of wine for me? Wow, that's so weird. Well, you know, it came from him, though, so you must give it to me. Like, there was prophets who would come in, and they would say, and it literally says in the Didache, if they ask for money for themselves during their trance, it's not from God. If they're asking for something for someone else, test it, because it might be. But people were coming in, and look, I'm so glad we don't have any false teachers today, right? So we don't have to deal with this. But people were coming in under the eyes. Remember, Jesus says, people are going, look, call me Lord, Lord. And I'm going, I don't know who you are. There's all these people who are coming in under the name of Jesus and talking to the church with supposed authority and leading them off course. Because here's the thing. If you're going this direction and you've got a long journey and you're just veer off 2 degrees, when you travel for a long way, you're a long way from where you're supposed to be, aren't you? Even just a little bit off. You can be gone and lost. And what John is writing to the church here is, hey, there's these people who are coming in and they're telling you what the new truth is. They're these progressive thinkers and it feels right and it seems like, well, maybe this should be. But let me tell you, the Jesus that we taught you first has never changed. John is saying to the church today, the Jesus that you knew at the beginning is the same Jesus in 2022 as he was in zero. He is the same today and tomorrow and forever. The Son of God who came to conquer death and take away the sins of the world. Come on, 930 crowd. Somebody give an amen. The truth is always the truth. We cannot back down from the truth. But we can't do it without love. See, that's what John goes, it's truth and love. Because too much truth turns people away. Highly religious people who don't let anyone else have any kind of say. We shut people out. But what John is saying is, hey, like, we don't have those people at our table. Those people who are teaching other things other than Jesus, no. We don't have time for them. But we do so in a loving way. We have to open our hearts and ourselves up so that those who don't know the truth can come to know the truth. That's what the church is. It's a place that stands on the truth of Jesus Christ and doesn't water it down for a modern day audience. Love isn't accepting all things. Love is walking with people through their hurts. Love isn't condoning. It's certainly not condemning. Love is holding someone until they know what that truth truly is. So we are called to be a church who stands on truth, but we do so with love. And as we do that, we will grow the kingdom of God, not for us. But so in 70 years, some pastor can stand up here preach to our children and our grandchildren the same truth with the same love. Let us pray. Father, we thank you and praise you for all the ways that you move in our life. Most especially, we thank you for your son, Jesus, who knew our pain and our suffering, who died so that we might have life. God, help us to know that truth. And Father, if there's someone in this room or watching online that doesn't know that truth, that Jesus died for them, may you pull them in by the power of the Spirit. May you whisper into their hearts. May today be the day that they say yes to you, that they understand what that truth means for them. Father, I pray that we would be a church who operates in such great love through the truth that you have given us, that people would know that you died for them, and that the kingdom of the world would cower as the kingdom of God comes forward. Father, we thank you and praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you stand one more time and worship? The ushers are coming forward and we're going to do the offering right now, and you're such a giving church that says yes, as it was clear last night through our event last night, but in all the ways that you give, most people give online these days or through the mail, but thank you for the way that you give. Father, we thank you and praise you for all that you have given us. All that we have is yours, and so we take a moment to give back to you. We say yes to you. We say that you ask that you would receive this offering, and through the Holy Spirit, magnify it, that others may know they are loved by you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Jesus, 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 there's just something about that name. Master, Savior, Jesus, like the fragrance after the rain. Jesus,
this benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you, lift his countenance unto you, and give you peace.